Skaven of Clan Eshin are well known for their toxic blades and their shadowy scuttling, and Skittershank's claw pack are some of the most devious. But will they survive the Nether Maze? In this video, we'll be showing you how to paint Slynk's Skittershank, and by following this, you can use them to paint the rest of your warband. So grab your brushes and shake your paint pots, let's get started. First off, we need to undercoat our model. As you can see here, I've used Mechanica Standard Grey, and then we can start with our first stages. So we'll start off with the skin, and for this we'll be using Dryad Bark for the base coat. So we're going to dip into the paint, and then we're going to just thin it down a little bit, a little touch of water, and then we can start applying it to the skin. So we're going to just apply it everywhere. Try and be neat if you can. Don't worry if you do get it on anywhere else, as we'll be painting that later. And now that our base coat is now dry, we can move on to some layers and highlights. We'll be layering up with some Gorthor Brown, and then highlighting with some Baneblade Brown and Rakarth Flesh. So, we're going to just get some Gorthor Brown out of the pot. I'm going to just take a small amount out. I'm going to thin it with a touch of water, just so it applies onto the brush a little smoother. There we go. And now we can apply it over the top. So we want to make sure that we want to avoid any of the fur patches, because we want to keep them dark as possible for the moment. But we're going to go over any kind of skin areas or any bumps that you can find. Remember, you can keep any recesses darker, as it helps with our shading. Now with that layer dry, we can move on to the highlights of Baneblade Brown, and we're just going to use that onto any knuckles or sinew areas that pop out. Just be nice and neat. If you do go over a little bit in a place that you shouldn't have, don't worry, just go back over with some Gorthor Brown. And now to finish off the skin, we'll be using Rakarth Flesh for our edge highlight. So we're just going to be careful, and we're going to use it on these knuckle tips and any fingertips that you want. You can use it on any raised areas, but we just want to add a little bit of highlight, not too much. And now that the skin is finished, we can move on to the nose and the tail. For this, you're using a base coat of Blood Reaver Flesh, followed by a layer of Night Questor Flesh, and then finishing off with a highlight of Kislev Flesh. So we're just going to dip into the pot of the Blood Reaver Flesh. We're going to make sure we get enough onto our palette. And then we're going to thin it down slightly because it's a little bit thick. Now we can get our brush to a nice point, and then we can start putting it onto the tail. So we just want to make sure that we're going to be nice and neat, and we're not going to get it on any of the skin that we've just painted, especially with that little nose as well that we're going to do. Now with that base coat dry, you can see I've picked out the ears as well. So now we're going to use our layer of Night Questor Flesh. We're going to use this on the tail. We're going to make sure that we don't get the rings of the tail, so we can keep them nice and dark, so we get the segmented look of the rat tail. And now with those areas picked out, we can finish off with a highlight of Kislev Flesh. And you're going to just use this on the very tippy ends of like the nose, the ear tips, and just taking out those segments of those tails a little bit more. With the nose and tail now done, we can move on to the fur and the leather. For this, we'll be using a base coat of Rhinox Hide. So we're just going to start and dip in, and we're going to thin it down like the other base coats that we've done in the past. Just make sure that our brush is nice and pointy as well. And we can start applying it. So we're going to avoid any of the areas that we've already painted. So we're just going to touch up the fur areas where they're going to be a little bit darker. We can move on to any straps and any pouches as well. Now now with our base coat dry, we can move on to some contrast and a highlight. For our contrast, we'll be using Saigor Brown thinned down with contrast medium, and then for our highlight, we'll be using Gorthor Brown. So let's get on with that contrast mix. So we're going to mix up two parts of contrast medium, and then we'll wash our brush off and dry it off, and then one part Saigor Brown. I'm just going to make sure that's nice and mixed up, so is that the right consistency? Make sure we haven't got too much on our brush overloaded, and then we can start applying it to our brown. So we want to make sure that it doesn't overflow onto any skin or fur that we don't want to colorize. So we're just going to get it on these leather wraps and any leather belts or pouches. And then we can make sure that we're going to be nice and neat for that fur. If you find that you got too much on into the recesses or over any areas that you don't want, don't worry, just clean off your brush and then you can mop it up with a dry brush. And now that contrast is now dry, we can use some Gorthor Brown to pick out the edges of the leather. I'm going to highlight some tufts of fur as well that poke out. So I'm just going to start highlighting these ones on the arm here. You want to make sure that your paint's nice and thin, but also use a very small brush as well so you don't get it on anywhere else. Now that our fur and our leather is complete, we can move on to the cloth wrappings. For this, we'll be using a base coat of Rakar Flesh, followed by a shade of Seraphim Sepia. Then we'll be finishing off with two highlights, one of Carrick Stone and another of Screaming Skull. So let's get on with that Rakar Flesh. So we're just going to dip out to the pot and pop it on a palette like normal. Now we want to make sure that we're using a small brush when we thin it down, because these wraps are very, very small. So let's pop them on. So we want to be super careful that we don't get on any of the fur or the skin that we've just completed. I'm just going to take my time. You may find that you want to put another layer on top. That is perfectly fine, as long as you get a nice smooth base coat. Now that's dry, we can apply a shade of Seraphim Sepia over those wraps. So, like before, we're going to make sure that we're just very gentle and we're not going to apply too much. If you find that there's a little bit too much on the wraps, don't worry, clean off your brush and dab it up. If you think it's not enough, don't worry, wait till it dries and you can apply another layer on top. Now that Seraphim Sepia is now dry, we can apply our first highlight of Carrick Stone. So, we want to make sure that this is a little bit thicker. But we want to keep some of that dirtiness to the cloth still. Make sure you don't get it on any of the skin or any toes or anywhere that we've already painted. And with that Carrick Stone now dry, we can apply our last highlight of Screaming Skull. So we're just going to be very careful with this because we only want to use it as an edge highlight. Be very gentle on those edges. Now that our wraps are finished, we can move on to the black cloth and the claws. For this, we'll be using a base coat of Abandoned Black, followed by a layer of Corvus Black, then two highlights of Eschen Grey and Dawnstone. So we'll start off with that base coat. So we're going to dip into our Abandoned Black, and we're going to get that on our palette as well. We can thin it down a touch, and we can start applying it to the cloth. So we'll be starting doing it on the hood. The Slynk wears a black hood over his head, and then we can apply it to his claw areas on his feet and his hands. Make sure you don't get it on any other areas. If you do, don't worry. If it's still wet, you can try and mop it up with a brush and then apply the other colours on top. Now that our base coat is dry, we can add our Corvus Black as our layer. So we want to avoid all the recesses and any dips and folds on the cloth, so we don't have to shade those again. But if you do go over into some of those areas, don't worry, just go and get some Abaddon Black again, thin it down, and you can add those to the recesses again. With that Corvus Black now dry, we can move on to our first highlight of Eschen Grey. So we're going to start with the folds of the hood, and just be nice and careful, nice and neat. Make sure that your paint is nice and thin as well. And if you do go in any of the recesses, don't worry, you can tidy that back up with any of the darker black shades. With that Ashen Grey now dry, we can pick out the top of those highlights out with some Dawnstone. So we're just going to be really careful, and we're just going to pick out those top areas. Be very careful to make sure it's nice and thin as well. And if you do go a little bit astray, or you think it's a little bit too thick, don't worry. You can always apply some more Ashen Grey over the top. Now that our black cloth is finished, we can move on to the grey cloth. For this, I'll be using a base coat of Ashen Grey, followed by a recessed shade of Basilicanum Grey, and then we'll finish it off with an edge highlight of Dawnstone. So let's get on with the Ashen Grey. So as before, we're going to get it out of the pot and pop it on our palette, and thin it down a slight touch, but because it's a layer paint, it doesn't need thinning too much. Now we can pop it straight onto that cloth. So for this, we'll be using on the trouser jumpsuit that he wears. So obviously avoid those arms as we can and any of the black cloth that we've done before. Make sure we don't get it onto those wraps as well. If you don't find it's covered enough, don't worry, wait for it to dry and then add a second coat. Now that our Ashen Grey is now dry, we can move on to the Basilicanum Grey recess shade. So we're just going to make sure that we've not got too much on our brush. I'm going to start gently, so we don't want to add too much to the recesses, especially when they're quite shallow. We want to pick out those really heavy areas, especially like these little holes on the trousers and where it's all rucked up around any armour. Don't worry if you go over the edges a little bit, you can always tidy up with some of that Ashen Grey. Now that our contrast is now dry, we can use the edge highlight of Dawnstone just on the edges of the cloth. So we just want to be very careful. If you do go over a little bit, don't worry, you can always tidy up with some Ashen Grey. Now that our grey cloth is finished, we can move on to our silver details. For this, we'll be using a base coat of Lead Belcher, followed by a first shade of Nuln Oil, then a second shade of Agraxo shade thinned down Alarmy Medium, and then finishing off with a highlight of Ironbreaker. So let's start with that base coat. So we're going to dip into our pot, and then we're going to thin it down because Lead Belcher can be a little bit thick. And we want to make sure this is nice and smooth on our model as a base coat. So now we can start applying it to anything that we want to be silver. So I'm going to focus around these blades. You can use it for any buckles as well. Just make sure that you're nice and neat, just so you don't go onto anywhere else that we've just painted. Now that our Lead Belcher is dry, we can apply our first shade, and we'll be using Nuln Oil. So we just want to make sure that it's nice and liberal. We'll make sure that we haven't got too much on our brush, and we're going to just gently go over all of the silver. If you do find you've got too much, don't worry, clean off your brush and then soak it back up. Now that our first shade is dry, we can move on to our second one. And for this, we'll be using a one part Agrax Earth 3 to one part Larmy Medium mix. So we're just going to add it in some of the recesses of the blade and the armour, just to give it a dirty effect of where we'd be collecting, but still being cleaned off in use of slaying their enemies. And now that Agrax is dry, we can move on to our highlight, and we're going to use Ironbreaker for this. So we're going to be just very careful of just catching the edges, just so it looks like it's quite worn. Just remember to keep your brush nice and pointy and keep your paint thin. So we just keep going along the edges, being quite careful. And you'll get this lovely effect. There we go, with that silver nail done, we can move on to the gold details. For this, we'll be using Balthazar Gold as our base coat, then a shade of Nuln Oil on top, then our first highlight will be Brass Scorpion, and then our edge highlight will be Ironbreaker. So let's go on with that Balthazar Gold. So we're going to dip it into the pot, pop it on our palette. Now it's quite a thin one, this one, but I want to make sure that it's nice and neat on my brush and nice and pointy. And then we can apply it straight onto the areas. So we want to focus around these pommels and handguards and any kind of trinkets that you also carry as well. I want to make sure that we want to avoid those fingers and that silver details that we've just done. You may find that you want a second coat, and don't worry, just make sure it's nice and thin on top. And with that base coat now dry, we can apply some non-oil to the gold. So you're just going to be careful and just add small amounts just towards like the centre where all these gemstones are and any kind of recess areas as well. Just on that pommel there. And make sure that you get the rings, especially around these rings on the tail around the cuffs of his arms as well. And now that our shade is dry, we can move on to our first shade of Brass Scorpion. So we're just going to be very careful around the edges. If you're feeling a little bit brave, you can add a few scratches and dimples into the gold by using it just very gently on the edges. And now we're finishing off the gold with our edge highlight of Ironbreaker. And we're going to use this on the most raised parts of the gold. Now that our gold is finished, we're going to move on to the red cloth. Now before we do this, we're going to clean out our water pot and get some fresh water in there, just so we don't get any metallic flakes into our red paint. And for the red paint, we're going to be using Galvor Black Red for our base coat, and then Word Bearer's Red for our chunky highlight, and then for our edge highlight, we'll be using Doomball Brown. So let's get on with that Galvor Black Red. So we're going to take a bit out of our paint pot. Galvor Black Red can be a little bit thin, so we don't need to water it down slightly. And then we can start applying it to the red areas. So for this, we're just going to apply it to the red of the hood. So just on this area here, so just be very careful. And it goes around down to the side slightly. And we've also got those tassels on the pommel of the swords. You may find that you need another coat of this. So just let it dry and then apply another thin coat. Now that our base coat is dry, we can move on to our first highlight of Wordbearer's Red. And we're just going to make sure this is a nice bold highlight. So we're going to pick out some of the pointed areas on the hood. Make sure that we get a nice, neat line along there. And then any of the raised areas on the tassels as well. And don't worry if you don't find your lines are nice and neat. You can always tidy up afterwards with our base coat. And now to finish off our red, we'll be using a subtle edge highlight of Doomball Brown. And we're just going to apply this just on the very tips and points of the hood and on any raised areas of the tassels. Now you might find, because it is quite subtle, you might want another coat. Now that the red cloth is now finished, we can move on to the green warp stone and poison effect. For these, we'll be using a base coat of Lupercal Green, followed by a Calabite Green layer, and then two highlights, one of Warp Stone Glow, and then a fine Moot Green highlight. Now let's get on with that Lupercal Green. So we're going to just get it out of the pot. It's quite a slightly thin coverage, so we're going to make sure that we don't thin it down too heavily, but we want it nice and smooth on our brush. So now we're ready to apply it to our poison effect. So we're going to just make sure that we get a good coverage. So we're probably going to apply a couple of layers, but we're going to make sure that we don't get onto the silver blade. And remember, on the hilt of the swords, there are tiny little gems, so make sure that you cover them as well. Now with that base coat dry, we're going to apply our Calabite Green, and we're going to use this for the majority of the poison. We want to get a nice coverage, but we're going to make sure there's a little bit of darkness still towards the blade. And remember to pick out some of those raised areas on those gemstones as well. And with our Calibite Green now dry, we can move on to our first highlight, and we'll be using Warpstone Glow for this. So we're just going to be very careful, and we're just going to use it on the raised areas. By using this, we're going to be slightly blending it with the colour underneath. And now we can finish off the green with an edge highlight of Moot Green. So we're just going to apply this very gently to the tops of all of those raised areas. So we just give it a nice glowing effect. And with the green now done, we can move on to finishing the base. For this, we'll be using a base coat of Mechanica Standard Grey for the stonework, Castellax Bronze for the pipework, then we're going to cover all of it with non-oil. So let's get on with that Mechanica Standard Grey. We're going to dip it out of the pot. I'm going to put a generous amount onto our palette. And get our base brush nice and covered. Now we can start applying it to the base. Now, it is already base coated in Mechanica Standard Grey from the start, but it's a slightly different tone, so we just want to give it a nice coverage, just so it's nice and even when we come to non-oil. And with the grey done, now we can add our Castellax Bronze, and we're going to coat the whole pipe that he stands on in the colour. Now be very careful not to get it on any of the painted model that we've done so far. And now that both of those base coats are dry, we can apply our Nuln Oil all over. So we just want to make sure we don't get into the fingers or the toes, but we want to make sure that it gets into those rivets of the pipe and through the stonework as well. And don't forget to do the bottom around here as well. And with that shade now dry, we can move on to the next steps. We'll be starting off with a dry brush of Storm Vermin Fur for the stone, then highlighting that stone with Dawnstone. Then we're going to be highlighting the pipes with Sycorax Bronze, and then finishing off with Warp Lightning thinned down with Contrast Medium for a gooey water poison effect. So let's start with that dry brushing. So we're going to dip in with our small dry brush into Storm Vermin Fur, and we're going to remove most of the moisture and the paint off of the dry brush, so you can just stab it into a piece of paper towel that you have on your desk. Now we have got a decent amount off, we can start applying it to our base. So we want to make sure that our strokes are gentle, and that we're going to make sure that we don't get it onto the pipe. Don't worry if you get a tiny amount on, it will just add to the effect. You may find that you want to do it again, so if you want to apply another coat of it, you're very welcome to, depending on how heavy you were in the first place. And now that we've done our dry brush, we can add our highlight of Dawnstone to the stone edges. We just want to be nice and neat. We want to make sure that we don't go into those cracks. Next, we're going to start highlighting the pipe with some Sycorax Bronze. So we're just going to highlight some of these brackets and these rivets and some of the puncture holes along the pipe and the edges of the pipe as well. And to finish off our base, we'll be applying a one part contrast medium to one part warp lightning to the bottom of the watery base. And this should give us a nice poisonous gooey effect. You can also apply it to the drips that are coming off of the pipe as well. And you can also kind of push it into this sewer pipe that sits underneath our base. And there you go, our base is finished. All there is left to do is to paint the rim in the colour that matches the rest of your warband. Here we have used the Baden Black. Now with Slink Skittershank painted and based, he can strike from the shadows of the Nethermaze. So just a couple of things to remember while you're painting. If you find that your shade or your contrast is pooling up in too many recesses, don't worry, you can always use a clean brush to soak those up. And when using metallics, always keep your paint water clean afterwards to avoid any metallic flakes going into your next colours. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you enjoy painting your own warbands, and we'll see you in the next videos. Bye bye!